Hello everyone, and once again welcome back to my channel Server Gyan. My name is Lokendra Singh, and first of all I have a request to make. Please be home, be safe, and do not spread any rumors. And until unless you are home, keep on learning. That will obviously help you out once this COVID-19 lockdown gets over, so that will be beneficial for you. Okay, so let's start with a couple of questions which recently I got to know that people are asking, and obviously like one of my friend has recently said as these questions were asked to him within an interview. Okay, so my very first question is, can you explain your infrastructure, or in other words this question be like, what all services are you using to run your infrastructure? So over here what you need to explain here is like from DNS to database you need to explain. First of all, for example, this is your DNS, like what service you are using for DNS. Then after, if you are using any load balancer, then you need to explain. You must know about that particular component. Then if you are using any application, so what type of application you are using, you should be aware of it. Like what all application servers you are using, then after what database you are using. So for example, this is DNS, this is ELB, and let us type it, let us write maybe a web server. First of all, we can write here web, and later on we can have couple of app servers as well for sure. So like these are app servers, let me type in here app, and once you have app servers available, then after you can have your database. So DB, database, fine. Now how do we say that this is a three-tier architecture? First of all, these are web servers, then after application servers, then database server. So this is how your infrastructure runs. Like first of all, end user will hit your domain name, request will go to DNS, DNS will send request to load balancer, then load balancer will send request to web servers, and web servers will send request to your apps, application servers. So then application servers will send request to database. Now there could be a question, what is difference between web server and app server? So web servers are just there to display the user content, like whatever content you want to display, so those servers are known as web server. Now app server means the particular logic which is supposed to be implemented when a user is trying to access your website. For example, that you go to any domain or you go to any website for purchasing mobile. So first of all, you will browse using web server. When you will add it to your cart or to your bucket, then application server will perform. Reason being, all the business logics are written on application servers. Fine. Then request will go to database, and so on and so forth. This is how the application structure works. So the difference between web and app server is clear, and this is it. Then this is how you can explain your servers. Moreover, like if you are using application load balancer, you are using network or maybe classic load balancer, then what is the reason behind using it? How many target groups do you have? What type of rules you have implemented? So for sure, if you are going to face an interview, so at least just give it a look, just try to get a chance to look at your current infrastructure, as you should be able to explain it while interview. Okay, so what type of load balancer are you using? So obviously, as there are three types of load balancers as of today on the platform of AWS, so let me show you that once again. Although I have created a couple of videos on the top of it, but though even I would like to explain it to you guys. It will take a while only to demonstrate that what type of load balancers do we have. So currently we have three. So once we click here, so like so we have application load balancer, we have network load balancer, and we have classic load balancer. So what is going to be your task here? You need to identify that what type of load balancer is being used within your organization, and why we have selected that type of load balancer to be used within organization. Fine. So these are the answers which you need to figure out. Obviously that depends on like organization to organization, and infrastructure to infrastructure, that what type of load balancer people start using and what is the requirement of organization. Fine. So it could be network, application, or classic. Next question will be, or maybe that question may be like, what type of operating system you are using? When we talk about these web servers, this app server and database, so there will be a question like, what type of operating system you are using? Maybe it could be running on Windows, Ubuntu, Red Hat, CentOS, SUSE, Nopix, Debian, Mandriva, whatever type of flavor you have. So you should have an answer here that what type of application, what type of operating system you are using on the top of these servers. For example, application servers are running on Ubuntu and maybe web servers are running on Red Hat or maybe on Windows. Fine. So you should understand, you should know about this, and for sure what type of load, what type of operating systems you are using in your organization. So you should be familiar with that as well. Okay. Then after, what app servers you are using in your infrastructure. So for example, you are running a banking system. So it could be WebLogic, it could be FlexCube, it could be Finacle, or it could be any other financial transaction system. So that could be there. So you need to understand, so what type of operating, what type of application servers you are using. And like it could be JBoss, WebLogic, or maybe any other. Fine. It could be Tomcat as well. So what type of application server you are using? Now, once you say that you are using this type of application servers like WebLogic, JBoss, Tomcat, so you should know how to configure it. What are main property file? What are main configuration file? What type of instances have you selected for those? For running those type of application? Why you have selected that type of application server only? Maybe T2 micro, T2 small, C4 large, C4D, 10X large, whatever type of instances you have. So why you have selected that? So that type of questions will be there. Okay, do you have public facing load balancer or internal load balancer? Okay, so let me tell you that thing as well. So whenever we go to create load balancer, so there are two type of load balancers majorly, like either internet facing or internal. If you have internet facing load balancer, so you will get a DNS name that will be accessible from the world. It means anywhere from the internet you will be able to ping, or you will be able to telnet that particular load balancer. Fine. But if you have internal facing load balancer, so it means the VPC which you will associate with that load balancer, only that VPC will be able to ping or will be able to access the resource which are hosted using this load balancer. Fine. So this is VPC level and this is public. So I hope this difference is clear. Okay. So now if we talk about like how do you decide server size. So for sure when we go to create EC2 resources, so we have to decide like what type of application servers or what type of EC2 instance we are going to create. So whether these are running on EC2, these are running on RDS, for example, if we talk about database, so whether we are going to use EC2 instances or we are going to use RDS. If it is EC2 instances, so what type of instance do we need to use? Whether it is going to be C class, it is going to be T type, it is going to be R, or it is going to be M type. So what type of instance we are going to use, we need to check it out. Moreover, there is one another service. If you are new to AWS and you have yet not explored, so there is a service which is known as AWS Cost Optimizer. So Cost Optimizer is a service which gives you recommendation that what type of instance will be best fit for your requirement, and that is for free. So let me show you that, like what type, what is the service actually. So the service here is AWS Cost Optimizer. Yes, so this is the particular tool, AWS Cost Optimizer, which you can use to identify which type of instances will be there or will be best fit for your requirement. Fine. So based on the requirement, it will give you like what type of, what all instances are under provisioned, over provisioned, or like optimized. So these type of findings it will share with you. Fine. And this is for free. You can start using it. Okay. So how do you manage load on website? So right now, how do you manage your manage load on website, or how have you used or configured load balancer? So for sure load balancer will be there to distribute load among multiple instances which you have created, maybe application or maybe web servers. But the requirement here is the person may try to ask that, are you using auto scaling as well? If you are using, so on what parameters you have set scaling policies, like based on load, based on traffic, based on like response time. So what are the metrics which you have decided to scale in or scale out your infrastructure? So obviously if someone is going to ask you that, how do you manage load on your website, so it means the person is trying to ask that how you are handling load on the top of your load balancer by the help of auto scaling group. So yes, you should be well aware of auto scaling as well. Okay, next question may be there, like how do you secure your website, or a person can ask you like what is use of security group and NACL, NACL. So security group is used to protect your instances, specific instances wherever security group is associated, wherein Network ACL is implemented on the top of your VPC level. It means all the subnet which are there or which are associated with that network ACL. So these will, network ACL will cover all the subnets. Fine. Then after, if we talk about like how do you take backup of your infrastructure? So for backup, there are a couple of tools available. So if you talk about EC2, so we have this particular tool known as Lifecycle Manager. Or if you talk about overall, so we have AWS backup in place. So it will be used for taking backup of multiple things. Like you can take backup of EC2, RDS, like different type of databases you can take backup of using AWS backup. You can create your own lifecycle policies. So you can create backup plan. So obviously you will have to start like from existing, or you can build a new plan. Then what type of like plan you want to have, rule, and all the things you can select here. So this is really good service to configure. You can explore it. So there are two options by default. So either AWS backup or like this one, what do I call it? AWS Lifecycle Manager. That is under EC2 section, but there is a difference. Lifecycle Manager is used only for taking the backup of EC2 machines, wherein AWS backup can be used to take backup of multiple services. Okay, so how frequently do you take backup of your infrastructure? So wherever you feel that your infrastructure is critical, like you are talking about your database, so you can take backup every 1 hour or maybe before that as well. But if you see or if you feel that your application servers are in place and you can configure the application server once again if required, you have a backup of all the configuration server, maybe on Git repository, so you can take backup maybe once or twice in a day. That depends on the requirement. And what is that requirement? So that requirement is known as RTO and RPO. Or a person can ask you like, what is RTO and RPO? RTO means recovery time objective and RPO means recovery point objective. So what is recovery time objective? It means, for example, like it is 531. So if your instance goes down, if your infrastructure goes down, so how soon can you recover that? Maybe within 15 minutes, 1 hour, or maybe 4 hours. So the time you will take to restore website, that is known as RTO, and recovery point objective. So for example, after 4 hours, you brought the site up. So how recent data will you be able to provide that? Or there will be another question for the same context, like what strategy do you have in case of any disaster? So obviously like there are a couple of strategies. So like the very first one is known as backup and restore. Second one is known as pilot tight. Third one is known as warm standby. And fourth one is known as multi-site. So these are a couple of methodology which you can use to share information about your backup plan and RTO and RPO. Okay, so how do you prevent your site from attacks? Do you have a person can ask you, do you have web solution? So how do you prevent your site from attacks? So the question here is that if there is a DDoS attack or like someone is trying to hit your website maliciously, so how will you prevent that? So by default, when you create AWS Elastic Load Balancer, maybe application load balancer, when you create, so application load balancer provides you a feature to integrate web solution. How do you do that? So let me show you that. So first of all, you will have to go to your EC2 console, go to load balancer. And when you go to load balancer, so there is a feature here which is known as, okay, let me go to load balancer. And under load balancer, there is a feature in the description box where you can integrate multiple services. So these services are like your WAF and Shield. And okay, let me just show you that. Like integrated services. So like you can integrate Global Escalator, you can integrate Config, or you can integrate AWS WAF. It means Web Application Firewall. So these are the services which you can integrate with AWS Elastic Load Balancer. So these services are there to prevent unwanted traffic, or you can block, or you can allow a specific user base. Fine. Okay. So like how can you secure site using CloudFront? So yes, if you have implemented CloudFront, so you can allow or you can block a specific countries on geographical reasons. For example, you don't want to allow traffic from India. on your site, or maybe you want to block your site, your all the traffic coming from Australia region or Australia country. So for sure you can block that. So there is a specific rule within CloudFront which allow you to perform this activity. Okay, so what tool do you use to monitor your infrastructure? So right now the person is trying to ask you that what type of monitoring solution do you have, like Nagios, Javix, Kivana, Prometheus, CloudWatch, or maybe any other tool if you are using. Fine, maybe Datadog, Splunk, whatever like tool you are using to monitor your infrastructure. So the person wants to know. Over here, the person can ask you like what type of components you are monitoring. Fine, so you should know that thing as well. For example, on a server, you should be monitoring like what is current, what is load average, what is memory utilization, disk utilization, then after your IO of disk, then after network interface, you should be monitoring network, network interface should not become bottleneck for your infrastructure. So these type of things you will have to monitor. Then after, what all services are running on the instances, like Apache, Nginx, Tomcat, WebLogic, maybe Apache Kafka, Druid, whatever services you are using. So those services you will need to monitor under your application server. Then after, there can be a question, okay, what is your log rotation policy? So log rotation policy can be managed in two ways. First of all, on operating system level, and then after service level. So if you are using JBoss, or if you are using Go, Node, or maybe any other application, so these application comes by default with a log formation. So one log pattern is already there, based on which you can start managing that. Otherwise, you can use log rotate D service within Linux operating system. Okay, so how do you ensure that your servers are patched? So AWS Inspector is the service which can let you know that whether your servers are patched or not. It means there is some vulnerabilities are available or not. So that sort of thing you can perform based on your AWS Inspector. Okay, so the final question is, how do you decide that what all components to monitor? Components means when you are talking about your 3-tier architecture, so what all services are there which you are going to monitor? For example, your web server, application server, inside application servers, whether you are doing APM level monitoring, it means application performance monitoring you are doing or not. What API is taking how much time? How much time one server is taking to give response? What APIs are taking how much response? If an API is slow, then how will you start troubleshoot it? What are the main components within that API which are making it happen that API is taking much and more time to give response to the application? So these are the things which you can start monitoring, and obviously it will help you out. Fine, so I hope this has been informative to you guys. Thank you so very much for watching. Once again, I would request you to please be safe. And if you have not subscribed to my channel so far, so please do subscribe, hit the subscribe button, and do not forget to press bell icon. Be safe, have a good time, and happy learning. Thank you so very much.